so we should begin by looking at my first presentation slide. So I fashioned a title for my, presentation. I call it Sustainable Agriculture Development Through the Palm Oil Industry. And this is on purpose because our palm oil industry is being pressured to produce palm oil sustainably, to certify for sustainability, sustainable production and so on. What is natural is that we are in the business of agriculture development as part of our economic activity. Next. As you can see, oil palm cultivation is an important land-based or asset-based economic activity of the agriculture sector. You might all know that statement, but the issue is people tend to forget that we are in the agriculture business of producing a commodity both for economic income as well as for food provision, supply. So like all economic activities, there is an impact on environment. So oil palm is no different. If you are in the habit of producing cars, manufacturing, whatever, you also have a lot of carbon emission, carbon footprint is big, and it will impact on the environment. So being an economic activity like digging gold or digging petroleum is the same. If you are producing corn, rice, there's a lot of environmental impact as well. But why focus only on oil palm? That is because palm oil is special in this particular field. So oil palm appears to be the only sustainable crop, and this has been proven by the large production of certified sustainable palm oil for the world market. Now, if you come to think about it, not so many other competing commodities are branded as being produced sustainably with certified sustainable production in large quantities. Soybean, not so. Rapeseed, sunflower, never. So we are therefore special right from day one. And because of that, probably we get attracted, or people get attracted to kind of attack us, demolish our reputation, because we seem to be sustainable from natural setting here. Malaysia pioneered the development of this industry, as you know. For the last 100 years, last year we celebrated our 100 year anniversary. So for the last 100 years we have been pioneering the development of the oil palm cultivation, palm oil production. No other country did that. We did it. And of course, many other countries followed later on. Palm oil has become the largest oil, replacing soya as the world top in terms of volume. And it has become, for our country, an $18 billion industry. That's plenty of money, $80 billion a year. Income from the oil palm revenue through exports. Malaysia established its own palm oil research institute in 79. I purposely mentioned this because this is a tool to make oil palm sustainable, competitive and successful. Without R&D, we would not have been where we are here today. And very few people realize the importance of R&D to support a vital commodity industry. This is very dedicated. It's called Palm Oil Research Institute, only for oil palm research at the upstream and downstream. Tell you a story. Palm oil was not edible before until we characterized through R&D at Pori to show how palm oil properties can be so suitable for food, and then it became standard oil for the world to use and to incorporate in their manufacturing processes for food production. So before that, palm oil was just good for steel manufacturing, to prevent steel from going rusty because of oxidation. That's what you found probably in your geography book long time ago. So we have gone a long way to make palm oil the main oil for food in the world market. And because of that, I believe we have contributed to the sustainability of agenda for palm oil, the three P's of sustainability: good for people, planet, and profits or prosperity. Next. This is just to show that we have been producing more and more palm oil since day one, in blue. But of course we have limited land. We cannot demolish all our forests and plant all palm. But Indonesia, with bigger land base, went ahead and overtook us 2006 and even became world number one. In case people ask you who is the biggest producer of palm oil today, it has to be Indonesia. You know, we have to be truthful about it. But we were number one for many, many years, a long time ago, as you can see. Next. This is different from what Professor just now showed. Commodity prices are so volatile, affected by volatility in the developed market business cycle and so on. But what is not volatile, as you can see, is the demand for oils and fats. And the supply, of course, will go accordingly to meet the demand. So this is a very simple fact. As you know, the world population is going to increase. And as you travel into the future, the demand is going up and up and up. So who is going to supply? And this is where R&D will have to come in. We have to find a way to improve the supply efficiency, higher yields and so on, to make sure that we can keep up with the demand trend going up and up. Okay, so that is opportunity. It's not a case of we meeting the inflection point and leveling off. It's not. Our imagination is the limit, because the world population is bound to increase and everybody wants food on the table every day, and palm oil is part of that food, so-called supply chain. Next. So as you can see, the trend is also clear which directions among the oils and fats produced in the world is going to lead us. And as you can see, in green is the palm oil share that is increasing more and more because of viability, sustainability, affordability, competitiveness. All the advantages would accrue to palm oil. And that's why the share of palm oil has been growing ever since we started the industry some 30, 40 years ago in earnest. So, can anybody suggest that the share of palm oil is going to decline in the future? You can't, because the trend is also very clear. All the other oils, they may shift a little bit up and down, but palm oil is dominant, and in the export market, is even more dominant. Next. See, in the export market, almost 60% is already palm oil based. People, countries suffering chronic shortages of oil and fat, got to depend on palm oil, otherwise they go without food. And countries, if they try to curtail the imports of palm oil, would only want to make their population suffer. You know, deny population access to oil, food oil, because there is no other alternative that they can import from. Can they import soybean in such big quantities, soybean oil, sunflower or rapeseed? The price will escalate so high that would be non-importable after a short while. So it's again, palm oil is the main component based on this chart that you can see. So please bear that in mind, that we are in a good business. Palm oil is here to stay for a long, long time, as long as the world population keeps on eating. Can you stop eating for a few days? Next. But the oil palm itself enables sustainable development of agriculture sector in Malaysia. And why is this so? Because it's so high yielding, so profitable, you don't need to open up so much forest to plant oil palm. So sustainability in terms of profits, there are the three P's, right? One is profit, So profit is already a given, as far as palm oil is concerned. Meaning that if you plant one palm, even if you plant cocoa, rubber, coffee, whatever, all can be planted, soybean can be planted in Malaysia. But we don't choose to plant them. We plant oil palm because profit is very lucrative. And with R&D, foreign and so on, as I said earlier, this will enhance our yield, our profitability for the oil palm sector. And therefore, we have come to occupy 70% of the agriculture area in the country next. Oil palm is naturally environmental friendly. Now, again, the three P's, I talk about the second P, planet. Environmental friendly means oil palm supports environmental sustenance. The oil palm output to input ratio, very important scientifically, is 9:1. This is very high output for every one input of energy, whether soybean or other crops, 3:1. So naturally, oil palm is the best crop to provide the maximum output for any input that you put in. And this enables Malaysia to only use 24% of its land for agriculture. We don't use 72% of our land for agriculture like the UK. And we can afford to retain 56% forest. We don't cut all our forests, leaving only 11% like in the UK and similar developed countries in the EU. So there you can see the natural advantage of sticking with oil palm as your agriculture crop for agricultural development. Because it's sustainable in the sense that it doesn't require too much land to create a certain level of income required by the country. As a perennial tree plantation oil palm through agriculture, though an agricultural crop, behave more like a forest plantation compared to soybean or rapeseed. I'm talking about emission, footprint, net carbon emission cycle. In fact, oil palm is a CO2 sequester, absorbs oxygen and give out oxygen, absorb CO2. So it's nothing in terms of CO2 emission if you compare with annual crop like rapeseed or soybean, which has to be harvested or rotated every year. So we have an agriculture crop, but it is also a forest plantation, similar characteristic in terms of carbon footprint. So the carbon footprint for oil palm is therefore superior to comparable competitors like soybean, rapeseed, and so on. So what is the world complaining about? We have a crop that is ideal for the environment as well. Next, look at what we can do. Palm oil is the only biodiesel source that reduces carbon emission. If you can take a bit of time to read this, the EU wanted to ban, mentioned by Prof. Vice Chancellor just now, biodiesel, presumably because palm biodiesel leads to deforestation and high carbon emission allegations. These are mere allegations. The facts have been misrepresented to disfavor palm oil, I said here. So soybean, as you know, yields 0.4 tons per hectare per year, and that would convert about 0.4 tons of biodiesel per hectare per year. If you replace by not using 0.4 tons of petroleum diesel, you actually save 1.26 tons of CO2 from being emitted to the world atmosphere. Right? It's very simple calculation. And if 1 hectare of soybean area is reforested, the trees will sequester, from the internet you can get this net, 5 tons of carbon dioxide per hectare per year. So to answer the European, we tell them, look, if you replant your soybean, your rapeseed, you actually get a forest to remove more CO2 than you try to do with your biodiesel from this rapeseed and soya, which is not really removing much of diesel emission, to replace diesel. So, but if oil palm at 4 tons per hectare per year, this is only a very average yield used, It will be 12, therefore, if by the cell equivalent, 12.6 tons of emission, and you stop 12.6 ton emission from petroleum diesel by replacing it with pump diesel.
Back up a year.
And the oil palm tree itself, as I said, behave like forest, will sequester another 5 tons of CO2 per hectare per year. 17.6 tons per hectare per year of CO2 is sequestered or not emitted by palm. So, if you are a real scientist, a real, you know, policy maker, which one you suggest? To ban palm oil by 2020 in Europe? Because of emission problems and continue to use soya and rapeseed? To me, it's a wrong decision. You know, you should ban soya and rapeseed forever because it is negative impact on CO2 emission. And all adopt soya-based biodiesel because it's a positive removal of CO2 by a big difference. So oil palm provide employment, food. This is the third P that I want to talk about, sustainability. Criteria for the third P, people. It's very friendly. If Malaysia were to produce the same amount of oil, 20 million tons, using soybean that we plant all over the country, it will take 1.5 times the size of Malaysia to plant soybean to get 20 million tons of soybean per year. Compared to our 20 million tons of palm that we get from 17% of the land use. But for soybean, we have to use the whole of Malaysia plus another 50% land elsewhere, maybe in the sea, you know, to get the same amount from soybean. So, is soybean friendly or palm oil is friendly to people? We need to live, we need to do other things, not just plant soybean. And if we were to adopt cattle ranching, cattle farming, livestock farming like Australia is doing, and we locate this business in the territories of Kalimantan, Sabah, and Sarawak to produce the same amount of palm oil or income that we derive from palm oil now, using 10% of volume with oil palm, we get 20 million tons of palm oil, let's say. With cattle farming, to achieve the same amount of income or equivalent to 20 million tons, we have to use the whole of volume for cattle farming. Then only we get the same amount of income. So is that friendly cattle farming? It's never declared sustainable anywhere in the world. And next. So biodiesel, I put it here as a reminder that biodiesel is not about fight against food against fuel. Biodiesel is used as a tool to limit damage to oversupply produced by oil palm and world oils and fats. So that any time there is an oversupply, we'll ramp up our diesel production and raise the price of palm oil for our farmers to benefit properly and not allow price to collapse. So we have a mechanism in which palm oil price can be protected from collapsing too low by playing the biodiesel market, playing the biodiesel sector, to draw away supply from the main palm oil market and let the main palm oil market price to go up, and biodiesel can safely be used in vehicles and transport because it's a good fuel. But we also created a lot of money. One of my contributions was to realize at MPOB long time ago that we can set up the biodiesel industry in Malaysia, so we raised some seed money, 75 million, put up 3 biodiesel plants. Now these plants are able to produce biodiesel and blend with the diesel market at 7%. And that creates a lot of income. 1 year we estimate income from the biodiesel industry of 2 billion ringgit in Malaysia. And we only invested 75 million ringgit initially to set up the seed money to get the plant started. Most importantly, like what Enoch lecturer was saying, biodiesel mandate is strongly implemented in Indonesia. They use, we shared this story, they use the same strategy. If they can siphon away part of their biodiesel, part of their palm oil supply for biodiesel use, then the main palm oil market will not be affected by oversupply and price will be defended. Next. And you can't do this for rubber yet, I think. So that's how biodiesel is so competitive, oil palm because of the high yield. Next. Biodiesel is also an international business or industry right now, and that's why the biodiesel industry in Europe is so big and strong and very jealous of not allowing us to enter their market and compete. But we have our own strategy of consuming our own biodiesel if we need to, so that's Indonesia and Thailand. Next. Now, this is for those who want to do research. Plenty of research areas to go into, especially downstream niche products, all these byproducts coming out from the palm oil industry, if you want to research into it. Next. I call this the ultimate sustainable oil. Look at how much land that is used by oil palm. 0.3%. All over the globe, all over the world. And that cannot be cause for climate change, cause for deforestation or whatever. Because all this climate change, deforestation is caused by cattle farming or what they call livestock farming in brown, right? 71-72%. Or other crops and the oil seeds. Oil palm is nothing, not even 1%. Your normal so-called fee for your, when you buy shares, they charge you 1%. That means not a very material thing. But oil palm land use is not even 1%. So therefore, it's not critical to the resource use in terms of forests and so on. Next. Oh, sorry, just before that. I look at the internet, they say grocery loss of over 50 million hectares per year. We have less than 15 million hectares of land, for oil palm in Malaysia. Is Colombia, Brazil, and other countries, not at all the palm oil countries. Next. So conclusion, example of a Canadian industry partnership with improvement in biodiesel technologies. I'm just talking about biodiesel. Don't do repeat research what MPOB has done. No, we have gone so far ahead in biodiesel research. But there is still room for improving biodiesel technology to make it more efficient and more competitive. And people are already talking about solid catalysts, superheated methanol, and hopefully these processes are more sustainable and environmental friendly. Next, last one. So, other examples, R&D in environment, to answer the critics of oil palm environmental NGOs accusing palm oil of deforestation. Show them data, show them research results published in Nature or international journals that oil palm is not a culprit. Oil palm is the solution, not the problem. Okay? And if you want conversion technology, I am aware of this area. It's very exciting. You can get enzymes to do whatever you do now, whatever you want. Just stick in the right enzyme, the right parts in the vessel, stir it for 1 week, and you get your new chemicals produced, provided you discover the right enzyme first. Okay, thank you very much. Next.